So as a result of that, they formed a group called the Democratic Republican Party. And we are basically going back to our roots because we believe, when I say we, the Democratic Republican Organization of New Jersey, or the Democratic Republican Party, however you want to refer to us, or the D-R Party, as the Division of Elections makes us represent ourselves, absent another court fight. But to cut to the chase, we believe that the system is broken. I've sat here this morning listening to everything that you've said, and I agree with a lot of the observations, but the thing that distresses me to see, as I pointed out to some of the people that I was speaking to, is in 1787, 39 people stayed till the end in Philadelphia and created the document that was the idea of America, that in the Constitution that created the world that we're supposed to be living. And it's been amended over time, and that's another story. But with regard to that, I sat here today listening to people that came here, I assumed, with the same goal in mind, but yet unable to, at least from my perception, agree upon a vehicle to address the situation. And my concern is, if you people with a common goal can't agree with each other, how are you going to put together some type of program to convince other people to get on the bus with you, so to speak, or get on the train with you for the journey? It's just not going to happen. Now, if you go back to 1787, you know, they had to make compromises, make deals, break bread, eat meals with people that they did not agree with, but there was a common goal, which leads me to the Democratic Republican Organization of New Jersey. The Democratic Republican Organization of New Jersey has its genesis in supporters that range from a gentleman by the name of Leonard Marshall, who was one of the original founders of the New Jersey Conservative Party with Tom Blomquist, who I was very close with. I litigated things for them, fighting for their civil rights and their right to, for ballot access during the 90s. And so, to be blunt, their conservative credentials trump yours. Then, we also have a gentleman by the name of Edward Forshaw. Now, no one knows him by the name of Edward Forshaw, but if you pay attention to foil hat crazy New Jersey politics, he's also known as New Jersey Weed Man. The point I am trying to make is the people that support our mission range from the liberalist of the liberal to the most conservative of conservatives. And the one thing that everyone agrees upon is that the system is broken, and we have certain ideas and goals on how to address that. So while, like I said, well, Mr. Weedman may support us, that doesn't necessarily mean we support what he says or stands for. Conversely, there's people in the group that don't necessarily support what the most conservatives of conservatives stand for. But just like the 39 people in Philadelphia had to get along and figure out a way to peacefully coexist to make things go forward, we hope that the New Jersey Democratic Republican Organization, which is in some respects a predecessor to the New Jersey Conservative Party in some respects, will be that vehicle, and let me tell you why. What we basically stand for is trying to fix the system. We're not speaking about any one specific issue. Like I joke with my brother, if someone were to ask me, what's your position on guns? I like brownies. Everyone thinks that's a funny line. Well, there's people that may take positions that are anti-Second Amendment or not as strong as yours. That doesn't mean, someone used the great phrase, the big tent. That doesn't mean you should cast them out of the door. You know, conversely, there's a lot of hot button issues that people take positions on, but those should not be the Rubicon where everyone decides that's what's gonna, you know, make or break my participation in this. Because if the system is broken, right today, we have a Democratic organization and a Republican organization. Both are broken, both are controlled by party bosses and money, and if you think anyone cares what you think in that organization either, you're kidding yourself. And by the way, there's no difference today in New Jersey between a Democrat and a Republican. It doesn't matter who wins. Now, as background, what we stand for is fixing it. I'm going to tell you exactly, specifically, how we plan on doing that, because I promised I would be less than 5 to 6 minutes. I'm about 4 minutes in. The first thing is with regard to money and politics, okay? The Citizens United case says that corporations are people, and they can give unlimited amounts of money, and I can't compete with Exxon. I don't know if you can, but I can, okay? So their money can mute your voice. Now, in Congress, the answer to that is very, very simple. We have a thing that we devise called the Change the Rules Pledge. Because if you continue to play, I've heard this morning, it's said many different ways. You keep sticking your finger in a birdcage. At one point, you realize stop doing it. You keep doing the same thing over and over again, expecting a different result. That's the definition of insanity. I have my own take on it, which is basically saying, if you play by their rules, you will lose because the rules were calculated to ensure that you can't win. Or to paraphrase my brother, if you're sitting around a poker table and you can't figure out who the sucker is, guess what? You know. And so don't play in that game. So let me get specific as to the essential three issues that the Democratic Republican organization stands for. And the reason why we use the name Democratic Republican is for multiple purposes. Firstly, it is the first political party ever in the history of the United States. So we trace our roots back to Jefferson and Madison. Number one, that's it. Number two, it was spurned and grew out of the genesis of the fact that there was a belief that the Federalists were not following the Constitution. Pretty much what appears to be what everyone in this room seems to think. The third is, my experience in both running as a major party candidate, being involved, representing both Democrats, Republicans, the New Jersey Conservative Party, everyone all over the map, is that when you talk about alternative political parties, people in New Jersey, and in the United States also, seem to have what I jokingly refer to as an abusive relationship with their political parties. It's almost like a bad marriage. If you have a husband that cheats on you, or a wife that beats you and runs around, you stay with them because that's all you know. And so when there were some of the greatest minds in this country in the 90s in the Senate thought about the possibility of starting a third party, and one of the realizations they came to is that people were uncomfortable with the concept because it's been ingrained over generations that we have a two-party system, which is a fabrication, because if you go back to history, we've had loads of other political parties that were very, very successful. It's just since the late 1920s when they changed the statutes in all the states, basically making it a two-party system to stop the progressives and the socialists. That's what we now have today, is a two-party system, which is really a one-party system. But the point being, people are uncomfortable. You know, people say, well, let's think about the Constitution Party or the Liberty Party or even the Conservative Party. People are afraid of names. So without sounding corny, the Democratic Republican Party essentially also says what we stand for. We are Democrats. We are Republicans. We are Americans. And we shouldn't let any definition stand in the way when we're trying to fix the problems. Now, with regard to corporate money, to get to the issue, how do we fix the problems? The three principles that everyone in the Democratic Republican organization agrees with are as follows, and everything else is up to you. First, the system is broken. The two-party system, the campaign finance system, the government, the way things work is broken. So for the moment, put aside issues. You can't talk about issues until you fix the system. So first principle of the Democratic Republican organization is acknowledgement that the system is broken, both the two-party system and money. We have to look in the mirror. It's like, I look in the mirror. I am unhappy. I've gained a lot of weight since I was young. But I would be denying reality if I said, I don't need to lose a few pounds. That's the first thing. The second thing is, how do we address the pervasive impact of money in politics? And we have an answer for that too. We call it the Change the Rules Pledge. You cannot regulate speech without stepping onto a very slippery slope. It's very difficult to parse words and say, well, this is allowed and this is not allowed. And we have an answer for addressing the Citizens United case without having to have a constitutional amendment or without trying to pass legislation where you're regulating speech or corporate speech. And it's very, very simple. The Senate and House of Representatives, each under the Constitution, fix their own rules for procedure for passing legislation. They're called the Senate rules, and they're called the House rules. And in those rules, that's where they determine who sits on what committee, what procedures you have for purposes of passing legislation, for proposing legislation, making amendments to legislation. And the only thing the Constitution guarantees one that is elected to public office as a member of the House of Representatives or the Senate is the right to be seated in the Committee of the Whole, the right to introduce legislation, and the right to vote on all legislation in final form. All other steps in the legislative process are subject to the rules of the House and the Senate as they see fit to pass. which significantly are what are called non-justiciable political question issues. By that means, the courts cannot interfere. As long as the person gets seated, has the right to introduce legislation, and has the right to vote in the committee of the whole, they can be denied the right to sit on any committee. They can be denied the right to make amendments in any committee. And in fact, if you've seen from people who pay attention, it's not uncommon for people to be stripped of committee privileges. Well, they don't run the court. They can't. It's the political process. So the change the rules pledge is very, very simple. If you run for office, you sign the change the rules pledge, and you agree to introduce and support an amendment to the House or the Senate rules, as may apply to you if you're running for the Senate or the House, that you will introduce and pass or support or endorse an amendment to the rules that says that if you take any corporate money, you are barred from any committee position, any right to vote in the committee, and that's it. All the dirty stuff is done in the committees. Exxon's not going to give money to someone if they can't do anything for them in committees. And I'm not demonizing Exxon, I'm just using that as a big example. And that is something that immediately takes the sting out of money. It doesn't take the money out of politics, but it takes the money out of the politician's pocket and the inability to immediately, directly affect public policy. We have a way to get around if they have ads to it. That's a little too complicated. I don't want to get into that now. The second issue, and I'll finish after this, is the Democratic-Republican organization acknowledges the existence, promulgation, and reality of the true Constitution, including the ratification and full consummation of Article I. Now that's a little esoteric. I'm only going to spend less than a minute on it, and if you're interested, I'll be giving lectures about it throughout the state. Everyone is taught that the Bill of Rights was originally 10 amendments to the Constitution, and everyone, you know, the 13 states ratified them, and everyone was happy. The only problem with it, that might be a nationalized version of history, but it is not a factually accurate. Originally in 1789, the biggest debate was not about speech and religion, it wasn't even about guns. It was about having fair and adequate representation and a guarantee of that in the House of Representatives going forward. Because the reality is we just fought a revolution, not over speech, not over religion, not over quartering of soldiers in our home, not even about unreasonable searches and seizures. We fought a revolution for freedom so that we would have fair representation. You know, the old phrase, taxation without representation is tyranny. That hasn't changed. During the debates in the ratification of the Constitution, the biggest argument wasn't about speech, it was about demanding a guarantee of fair representation in the House of Representatives. The first proposed amendment to the Constitution, Article I, guaranteed that there would never be more than one representative for every 50,000 people, which today would be 6,000. Now, it's not a question of whether or not it's a good idea. If you truly are constitutionalists, the question is, if it's the law, then you're obligated to follow it unless and until such time as an amendment is brought to change that. Well, what most people don't know, and anyone that's listened to my lecture, and Rich Luzzi can probably attest because he's seen the proof, the reality is, it's a long story, but in history, this amendment was lost because the state of Kentucky ratified it, never reported it to anyone. The state of Connecticut ratified it, never reported it to anyone. And the state of Pennsylvania is erroneously listed in unofficial publications as not ratifying this amendment. Translated into basic fourth grade math, there were 15 states, because you had the 13, originally we had 11 states during the first session, then North Carolina joined, 12, Rhode Island, 13, Vermont, 14, Kentucky, 15, 12 of 15 states ratified Article I. A pure 3/4 under the Constitution's Article 5, the standard for ratification of an amendment once proposed, would be 11.25. Whether 11.25 is 11 or 12 is really incidental because 12 of 15 states ratified. This is not my opinion, this is fact. I've written a book about it, I've given lectures on it. It's amazing to me that this most important story is not getting out there, and the reality is, how do we change the world? Change Congress. And how do you change Congress? Instead of 435 elitists that need $4 million to run a credible losing campaign, you can run in districts of 50,000 people where you can do that by knocking on doors. So how do you change the world? Change the rules pledge, acknowledge the ratification of Article I, and that's what we're fighting for. And we're asking other groups, ranging from the Tea Party to the libertarians, to the weed man, to get on board and support us. Because once everything is fixed, only then will you have a fair forum to talk about issues. You can talk about all the issues you want in this room, but you people pretty much agree with each other. So you're preaching, pardon the phrase because we're in a church, you're preaching to the choir. You know, you're not wasting your time, but you're not making any change. And you're not convincing anyone. You know, no one in this room, if you're taking time out on a Saturday to come here to do this, no one in this room needs convincing that the government is broken and that something needs to be done. We're telling you what we're already doing. So we hope that you consider, joining along with us, getting together with us. We're not looking to control anyone, nor are we looking to be controlled. But we are looking to make positive social change. We've already done it, which I'm not going to get into it because I don't want to monopolize. Everyone's been nice enough to allow me to speak. But I want to thank you for your time. I want to ask you to consider finding out a little bit more about what we're talking about and maybe jumping on board the train.
Do you have a website or something you could say right now?
Absolutely. What is it? It's democratic-republican.org.
democratic-republican-party.org.
Yeah.
Okay, that's
on
the
Say it's Google Democrat, just Google democratic-republican.org and it'll come up. All right? So thank you very much.